African ancients, Bantu bricks, and Rhodesian revisionists. Let's learn the fun side story of Great Zimbabwe. In the classic book about European imperialism, Heart of Darkness, the main character speaks of a fascination with maps as a boy. He would pore over the empty spaces, and he specifically cited Africa as a delightful mystery. When was this book set? Most likely around its publication date, 1902. You say, Africa was a blank spot on the map that late in history? While Europeans had conducted imperialism for centuries, colonies in Africa were quite the late development. From 1881 to 1914, 80% of Africa was swallowed up by European powers in what was called the Scramble for Africa. Difficult geographic obstacles to the interior had kept Europeans' grubby hands off for a long time. Yet now, beyond military and economic reasons, toxic ideologies fueled this colonialism. Colonies were tied to a country's greatness, but also the notion that Europe was responsible for civilizing the whole world, otherwise known as the white man's burden, played a huge role. Somehow this soap makes me feel dirty. It would be quite inconvenient then if this so-called civilization already existed in Africa. To be sure, civilization is a loaded term. Europeans often look down their nose at people from Africa, the Americas, the Pacific for their lifestyles, which in their mind tended to be less developed. Look everyone, I love electricity and I love my flush toilet, but who's to say which way of life is better? Living closer with nature, focusing on family rather than spending your life as a wage slave? That does sound nice. In fact, we have multiple historical examples of Europeans leaving home and later deciding to live a not-so-European lifestyle. I happen to make a video of a group of British sailors doing just this in the South Pacific. Click somewhere here to check that out. In sum, no culture is the supreme authority on civilization or how people should be leading their lives. But Europe certainly thought it was in the late 1800s. In 1871, a German explorer happened on massive ruins in what's now Zimbabwe. Absent all that previous civilization talk, even by European standards, these ruins were impressive and clearly the remnants of a sophisticated society. This was Great Zimbabwe, a complex of walls, dwellings, and public areas built from stones put together without mortar. This site was likely built by the ancestors of the Shona people, named Zimba Zimbabwe, or Houses of Stone, and operated as a trading center with the east coast of Africa, and in its 2 centuries of existence, possibly housed up to 18,000 people. Examples of gold working, trade artifacts from as far away as China, and large soapstone carvings of a bird motif were also found. Today, Great Zimbabwe is a center of cultural pride, lending its name to the country itself and the bird motif appearing as a national symbol. However, this presented a problem for the colonizers, particularly as this place was once located in the colony of Rhodesia, named for the notorious British imperialist Cecil Rhodes. Rhodes would likely dispute he was a racist, but his view that sub-Saharan Africans were just leaving a state of barbarism would at best be called paternalistic. Upon his death, Rhodes' will even advocated for the creation of a secret society to help the English race conquer and civilize the world. So... racist! How then could you justify colonizing a people who in the past had controlled enormous amounts of wealth and had exhibited significant urban development? Oh, my friends, you need to start thinking like a colonizer. The answer is, just make up that non-Africans had built these structures. Due to some obscure theories from the Portuguese, the first Europeans to hear of this place in the 1500s, a strange biblical connection was drawn to King Solomon. King Solomon, famous for his love for the African Queen of Sheba, was also said to have received gold from a distant land called Ophir. Since gold deposits were found near Great Zimbabwe, the British thought they had found Ophir and assumed a Hebrew connection. This theory was so pervasive that a 1905 study cited the local Zimbabweans as having, quote, physical features of strong Jewish type with customs distinctly Jewish, end quote. Evidence? Other theories suggested that the Phoenicians from current-day Lebanon had set up a colony in Zimbabwe. This theory was advanced in works of fiction by H. Rider Haggard in his book Elisa and the Doom of Zimbabwe. You might not be shocked to learn that Haggard's preface to this story cites the downfall of the Phoenicians as a result of race mixing and being overrun by savages. Anybody shocked?
Nobody shocked.
So by that logic, 3,000 years ago, people from here set up colonies here. Yeah, that's not a thing. Thankfully, finally, present-day scholarship accepts the native origin of the site. There is a cautionary tale here. Unfortunately, if things aren't written down, there is no history. This has severely disadvantaged people without a traditional writing system. And in the case of Great Zimbabwe, it means that foreigners with an agenda wrote their history, oftentimes making up things out of whole cloth. So write your thoughts down, upload them to the cloud, or write them on fireproof paper if that exists. You'll be doing future historians a great service. That's all for now. Remember, history isn't just kings, dates, colonizers, whatever. It's a story of you and me in different circumstances. One big soap opera, and we should learn it that way. Don't forget to follow me on Instagram, join the discussion on Reddit, and check out my Patreon. And subscribe to my channel, man. Ring the little bell wherever it is so that you get notifications of when I make my next videos. See you next time.